say before that I registered a lot of talks, and I was most afraid before this talk because I have no real proof that I'm competent to talk. So I just had some ideas and think it is good to talk about ideas, and I hope we can improve this in this both to something more than I can present here on the slides. Well, I just thought about what to lead. If I'm speaking about leading a free software project, then I thought about who to lead, and lastly but not least, how to lead. So what to lead? What is in general the motivation to work on free software? I think the first motivation is getting something to work for yourself. So normally you see, I want to do a certain task, there is no ready solution, I just want to have a solution for myself and just start coding. And people who are entering the Debian conference have probably understand if you release your code as free software, you get some co-workers. Because there are, at least chances are good, that there are people out there who have the same or similar task, and if they know about your project, they think, hey, perhaps I can join this effort and we can split the amount of work between those people. So releasing the code as free software is a clever thing, and finally it's something to get it working for your own task. And perhaps releasing code is also something to get friends, even if people are not able to do some coding and so on, are just using your project, they will probably just love you if it works. Okay, the example and why I was motivated to do this talk is that I am more or less the leader of Debian Med. I do not really like the term leader, I just would call myself initiator of the project. But if you issue an announcement of a project, this is probably the first mistake if you want to avoid becoming a leader. Because, well, those people who are thinking, well, this is a nice idea, often tend to regard the person who just made the first announcement as somebody who is competent and has thought long about it, which is not really wrong, but, well, sometimes it is more than just an announcement. If you, after this careful infrastructure, so like create contact pages or ask for mailing lists on the Debian web server, you most probably make the next mistake if you want to avoid to become a leader. Or at least people respect you as such a leader because you are the man who did some work for a common project. And I learned that those people, well, just asked me for some advice on positions where I was not able to give any advice. And so I said, well, we just try this, and if we are lucky, it works. And so finally, if you try to do some reasonable stuff that brings the project forward, people tend to draw you in your leading position. So what if you are in this position? You can either accept it or think, well, I'm not really fit. But I think if there is nobody else who does it, you have to accept it. And this is kind of, well, duocracy. So if there is somebody who does something, who becomes the person who is giving the direction of the project or whatever. And the thing is that you should try to make it more or less in a way that people won't accept you as a leader, and so you make sure that other people will join this effort. If you try to do some things other people will not accept or will not like, then you will lose your basis for your work. And so you have to just continuously check whether things go well, whether people are happy in this project, And to come back with the DeviantArt stuff, I started this in 2001, and in 2001, and well, I was basically alone, and started a mailing list, and this mailing list, the members of the mailing list, the number of the mailing members, has grown, and I just learned that I can more or less ignore certain parts of the project because it's, the people are keen on working alone on this, and this is the best thing you can do. If our people working on a goal you more or less defined, and you can leave them alone, and there's no need to for any intervention, and so, and I can put my concentration on different things. So now I want to say something about whom to lead. I think the first thing is, if we speak about free software developers, that they are normally individualists. So, well, these people, I try to say, they just not behave, just behave different from normal. If we look at the usual computer user, I think we are not the usual computer users. We are something different because we want to dive deeper into the project. We want to get some more and do not accept what others present us. We just are seeking for different ways to do some things. If not, we would have this shiny great green grass background with a blue colored sky and the white clouds, which is, by the way, a really bad image, if you ask me from the viewpoint of a photographer. But, these people, the free software developers, also in real life, refuse to accept leadership. If you look at the t-shirts of these people and look deep enough, you can learn that they, well, just won't do something against it. Sometimes stronger, sometimes not so strong. When I was on Linux Talk this year, I was a little bit impressed because the people had the face of the German Indian Minister Schäuble on their t-shirt, and then wrote Stasi 2.0, and the Germans will understand it. I do not really like this sharp, it's a little bit harsh, but what I want to say is those people are not keen on being leaded by anyone. They just accept leadership of somebody they can respect and they can agree with normally. Also, we are mostly technical focused people and can be leaded by good technical arguments. If you have no good technical background, you will not be accepted as a leader. I think that's really sure. It has not been a very strong background, but a technical dilettante will not be leader of a free software project. So a little bit of feeling is necessary. And finally, you have no handle to force those free software developers. If you try to force anybody, he will go away. I'm really sure, because there is no other motivation than working on their own project and, well, if somebody is forced to do something he does not want to do, he will leave this project. So we have some differentiation between an employee versus a free software developer. For instance, the employer-employee relation is, they have a common interest, they want to make some profit. And both of them try to gain this goal and step back with personal feelings, because they just want to gain money. They just want to gain money, both of them, and there are some rules they have to accept to get this working. And an employee can be fired. This is different between a free software project leader and a developer, because they are just not interested in making money. They want to make their project running. It might be that at some point, anywhere, can somebody earn some money with this project, but it's not the main focus. And what is also interesting that sometimes this something they are working on is different, and so they has to find some compromise and try to make things working to get some common interest, and that the project is approaching in more or less the same direction. You can't fire a developer, but you can lose interest, and it is really hard for a project if a developer loses interest, and some projects will die if some poor developers go, or there will be forks, which is in most cases not a really good solution, but in some cases it can work. But it has mostly something to do with differences in between developers and leaders, and some developer tries to lead his own project, which might be more successful, but this is not guaranteed. So,
going back to your previous slide, the one before that even, where you said...
By the way, this is above, you can every time interrupt me, please do so.
That's where you cannot tell a developer what to do as a leader.
Yeah.
The other way around is also true. I've had developers tell me, please test this now, because I would like to integrate it. And you cannot tell the lead to do that, because he's also spending his free time on it. So sometimes you will just have to wait until the leader or the release manager or whatever gets around to looking at your changes, and especially if they're invasive.
Yeah.
Please be patient.
And if you are looking as a leader, as only one developer, he is a developer as everybody else, has just a little bit different position, but he is also a free software developer, and you can no developer force to do anything. This is absolutely correct.
Actually, I think you can maybe not force people to do something, but maybe lead them into doing it, or sometimes lure them, I don't know. As long as you have something they don't have, and you can give them. Just as you can have your employees do something they don't want to do, because you can give them money.
Yeah.
You can get people in the project to do something because you can give them, I don't know, add the feature they are wanting to add, or say, I will apply your patch if you make it better, or you add this feature, or you make it more generic, add documentation, and so on. There are ways to. Sorry?
I don't think that will work.
Well,
if you try to do a tit for tat sort of thingy, I integrate your patch if you develop this sort of thing.
Well, it has to be related. So
I don't think it will work long term. I think if you try to do that, people at one point in time will start feeling coerced. They're not going to be, I'm writing this because I want to write it, but they're starting to feel like it's sort of, I'm writing this because I have to do it, because otherwise, I don't know, this other thing doesn't happen. What you have to try to do is, you have to try to make them want to do this, which is not difficult.
So the trick is not to do it explicitly, but to do it kind of implicitly.
Exactly.
Sam was also talking about the training of features.
It's not about giving this or that, it's about making what they contribute, making it better. It's on a case-by-case basis anyway, because all the developers are different, but you can definitely say, I will implement your patch if you're not using, I don't know, a specific instruction for or from this library or something like that, make it more generic and so on, and people will eventually learn to write better code.
Okay. That's sort of a different.
Sure. You can never make someone do something that he doesn't want to do if it has no relation with what he is actually doing. But sometimes you can just push a little bit and get big things done.
The thing is, if you do listen to what a project leader or release manager has to say and try to implement his wishes, then he will be much more inclined to look at your code in depth and to integrate it, because you have shown that you are willing to work with him. Well, if you just say, okay, here's the patch and please accept it, and I'm not willing to discuss problems in it or whatever, he's going to say, ah, well.
I think as free software developer, you have to be much more clever to get people in the direction you want them to go.
Yeah.
Because you have no handle to force them. If you are really clever, you find ways to be happy to do what you want them to do.
I don't think that you have no handle on developers.
Excuse me?
I don't think that you have no handle on developers. I think there's one handle that you have, and the handle is love for the code and love for the project.
Yeah.
You can't overplay this, and you have to be very careful in how you do it, but I think this is the only handle that as a free software leader you really have.
Yeah, but if the different, they have different opinions about the code, you have to
convince him that...
Yeah, you have to convince him. This is not a handle, this is some kind of...
Well, okay.
It's not like an employer.
Of course you can't force him.
The lines also get very blurred because there are some people who are employees who are employed to work on free software projects. And so you might be a free software leader and you might have some volunteers, but you might also have some employees or some sponsored people or something like that who are working for money. So it's not... They don't report to you though. They report to somebody else. Yeah. Well, in some cases they may well report to the... Yeah, depending on what the arrangement is.
In my opinion, for instance, one side effect is, by the way, that very often the documentation is not so good, because writing documentation is not real fun. So nobody can force a developer to write good documentation. So there are projects with perfect documentation, but if you look inside, it's...
But it's a different set of skills to write code and to write documentation.
Yeah, but you have to convince somebody to write this documentation.
But not only that, some people try with all their hearts to write good documentation and it sucks. They may be great coders.
It touches on something that an earlier talk, the person talked about. You don't want to really force the programmers to force themselves to write documentation. You want to add new people who will maybe want to become programmers, so they will learn the code and then, by the way, document it, or if you don't need, not all documentation is API. Some documentation is actually for users, you know, not everyone thinks it's obvious to click cancel if you want to cancel. No. So documentation is a whole different beast. So it takes a different kind of people.
Go. I think one handle you would put, just use one handle, is probably just the quality and what is good for the project, saying, especially as a leader, this is good for Debian as a whole or for this project. Might get people to do something which is not very sexy, but for a short time of time.
But
we have to fix this bug, for instance.
Yeah, but in principle, if you look at release management, it would be good if you all would fix your release critical bugs. It would be really good. But, if they don't do it.
It's why mission statements are a good thing. Someone else talked about that. If you set the general scope, there are no major disagreements about what needs to be done. Yeah. Maybe you have people lagging and slacking off, and I don't want to do this right now, but they all know that it has to be done eventually. And then you can get into the time bit release and stuff there. But if you have a clear mission statement, then at least everybody knows that it has to be done. So there's no essential conflict between, I don't want to do it because it's stupid, and you can affect your power as a leader if slowly.
Yeah.
One handle that you can sometimes use is guilt.
Sometimes
people will make promises like, okay, I will look into that, and then later you can say, have you had time yet to look into that? Really, really careful, but still it's a reminder that, well, they're supposed to be involved in the project and maybe they've been spending time on other things. And so it's a kind of way to try to softly drag them in. And I found sometimes that guilt can be very effective.
So, using some technical tools.
Guilt generator.
Okay. So, well, the next slide is is about being their boss. I think by all means communication channels like email, IRC, even blogs or even wikis for certain things are a very important thing that you all the people are become informed what you are wanted to do, and which is also an important thing in case of trouble, use some other things like phone or real life communication. I think if we would have some more real life communication with hands off of the keyboard, it could help in some places. I'm really sure.
For instance, you cannot stress that enough.
Yeah. For instance, Francis here, the Sven Luther case, I really like Sven Luther. He's a friendly person in real life. But if I read all these emails, I'm so sad, because it's really sad. And so, yeah, if we would meet more person, or we had more interpersonal communication, it might be better. I'm just, I can't be unsure, but I think this is a real important matter.
I don't think the problem with Sven is that there is not enough communication.
No, this is a wrong communication channel.
Yeah, that's what you're saying.
No, the problem is that the communication is bad, and that both sides don't notice that they're miscommunicating.
Yeah.
I don't think you can solve that with more communication.
Yeah, but that's
you
the can exception. Different exception. Let's not reduce everything to Sven Luther.
Yeah, sure.
No, I don't think that he's an exception. I think that he's just one of many cases of communication going wrong, and he's maybe a very spectacular case, but in the end you have a lot of those cases all over the place. They're called different and they pop up on different mailing lists, but
in a general leadership sense, you don't always have such problems as when you're escalating everything.
Oh yeah.
The little nuances help the project much more if you can handle little communication problems and big, rather than concentrate on how do I fix if somebody gets hit by a bus, or, let's not go to extremes.
Yeah.
Keep it generic, and maybe.
Sometimes also if you learn people to know by email or CEO and see them later on the laptop, you start behaving different. You learn to the face of the person, you know how he behaves, and so you just react different. And this is, it works to a certain point with this electronic communication, but above this point we should use some other communication channels.
Just add one more thing.
Sure.
In the slide you say use communication channels and then in case of trouble. I don't think you should really mean in case of trouble with communication.
Yeah.
But a case of trouble with something else, because, for example, I do mirror stuff in Debian. And if, the Spanish mirror goes offline, as it has 5 or 6 times in the last few years. If someone sends me an SMS about it, that will automatically increase guilt, increase my interest in general, increase the feeling of somebody cares that you do, that you fix your stuff. Maybe this is an orthogonal example to software development, but if there's a security problem, communicate it more efficiently to someone, and then they really realize that there's no room for, maybe it's not so important, maybe nobody really cares, why should I really bother?
In some cases, a generic message to a mailing list will get lost, while a personal reminder will get the job done. On the other hand, too many personal reminders will definitely not work.
So what I also got is really important, give periodical reports. So people are working in their day-to-day life and they just like it if they know how we made some progress. Or even if there is not so much progress, you can say, well, we tried and had this and this problem or so. So the period of the reports depends on the project. But I think it is quite important to keep people informed. This is in several instances in Debian not well done, and this is the main point of critics of mine. I would like to do this better. I have to admit I'm doing it also not so regular in the Debian 8 project, so I'm not better in this respect, but I think it's an important point. So ask others about problems. If you have no response from others, well, you don't know if they are stick to some problem, and just keep people informed and be informed about the problems they possibly have.
Just one more point. Service tracker, bug request tracker, a tool for tracking things is a good thing for communication in general. You know, in the context of asking others about problems and everybody saying them to you, mails not getting lost, guilt being distributed nicely, and all that. You know, it should be mentioned as a,
yeah, this is
as a means of verbosity.
I think I have to rework the videotape and make some rough tours and stuff.
Maybe.
So, a very more important point is be nice to your people. Yeah, it is. Sometimes people are sitting in a high position tend to become harsh to others. This absolutely has to be avoided. And I think one thing I'm doing very consequently, if somebody has done a good job in the DBMA project, I just announce this on the mailing list and say, well done job and keep on the good work. And this, I think people like it, and I had a very good response about this. If someone provided unexpected things, so things you do not really want or do not really think are good, try to elaborate whether we can change it for a better direction. It is a little bit, the interesting thing in free software is that it is not really predictable what happens. And so if something new is growing up, just observe it and try what will come out of it. Moreover, try to serve as an example for the people in your group. I think it was Einstein who said the best thing in education is what you can do, be an example. And if not other, if not possible, try at least a bad example. So, it is, well, I try to be a good example and try these items to follow these items, but be open to your co-workers and just be nice to them. Well, the whole talk, not the talk, but these slides talk more about kind of a leading role than a strong leadership. Because it just not works in free software. You have to try to move the project in certain boundaries, but these boundaries should not be so strong that people would drift away. And finally, in the point, be nice, try to avoid cabal. Well, just in the talk before, we heard the famous word cabal. But it is hard to decide whether there is a cabal or there is not a cabal. People like to talk about the cabal. But even if people start talking about the cabal, then something is in the air what is not so nice as it should be. So why leading at all?
I think there's almost always a cabal.
Yeah.
The question is if it's really a bad thing or not. It's a bad thing if the cabal is closed, but in general there will just be people that are doing so much more work and are so much more involved in basically the heart of the project that by reason of doing the work they get to make the decisions.
Yeah.
And to people that are outside that can look like cabal. But basically it's just the way free software works.
Yeah, I think the smell of a cabal occurs if there are people who are doing very much work and the people who are not providing so much work do not really understand what happens because they are not so deeply involved and they think those people are cabal. So if it is this way, that people just could try to gather more information to get, have the insights covered, then it's okay.
It's basically really about openness.
Yeah, it is about openness.
Yes, it's more about information than really decision making and power, because it's obvious that the people who do the most work get the more power and control, but it's about the information that doesn't
get.
And it's about process. Due process, you know, the legal term. But there should be a process for doing everything. There should be a process for not doing something. You know, the legal, make it possible for people to get rejected on their idea. You know, legitimately rejected. You know, we think this is a bad idea and you should go away.
It's about being able to discuss decisions before they are made, basically.
Procedures, establish a certain set of rules, and then...
Oh, just to enter the cabal by just doing more work for the project. This is an easy way to move forward.
Yes.
Yeah, if it is possible to grow up into the region of the cabal, then it's fine.
That's my point, basically. To get people to do things they don't want to do.
Yeah, you're right. We have a very clever job.
I would also add that a cabal is an Indian decision group. If the group is open, is defined, is official, it's not a cabal, it's a committee.
Yeah.
So maybe it's better having a committee than
this is what I meant with avoid the cabal.
Yeah.
If people are just talking about the cabal because it's just fun to talk about the cabal, then it's okay. But
they talk about it if they don't have anything else to talk about.
Yeah, that's the thing.
Give them something to talk about, and then they'll talk and then they'll stop. Eventually, you have to start talking about something tangible, something,
about this.
If there's a feeling or something, then of course they will talk about it endlessly.
Yeah. And if they have so much time, they can talk about endlessly.
There will always be someone with too much free time.
But you can also equate cabal a little bit with insiders.
Yeah.
And that's something that will always happen.
Yeah, you can reduce it.
You can reduce it. If the cabal uses a basically open IRC channel to do their discussions, you could say, okay, by definition, that's not a cabal.
I'm not sure it happens that much at the technical level, but more at the political or legal decisions, like the license changes we've seen for X11, Apache, or...
This was not really by a cabal, but you have this general resolution or whatever.
And then people feel they have a right to be involved in the decision process, and sometimes it's taken away from them.
But you also see what happens in the case of XORG. There's a fork, and the people who proposed the license change were punished very badly, because basically they've become completely irrelevant. So there's a very large self-correcting mechanism in the open software world.
Yeah, it's what self-control.
Yes.
So is this more about factionalism, or is this more about cabal? Obviously, is pejorative. It has negative nuances. And there's a if you spell out a clear meritocracy, then you know what it takes to get to the inner circle, and it's very clear for everyone. But then I think what you're talking about here is more of factionalism, which happens in all sorts of companies. You sort of back one set, another group backs another set, and this set wins, then these people are now out of favor. I think those are different, unless I'm misunderstanding. But I think as long as you're, once again, being open, being transparent, letting people know that if you do this step, you too can be part of the, you'd never use the word cabal, but you can be part of the, your influence grows as the amount of work and the quality of work that you turn in grows.
I think so. So, why meeting at all? Well, it is just to coordinate the projects. You need some clear path to go. And you have also to define certain tasks which are to do, to get this task done, which you want to do. It is also necessary to mediate between the members if they are different opinions. So we have seen several escalation between members, but in most time it was fixable. I said it about real life communication. It is the best way to mediate and sometimes you fail, but this is normal. But as a leader, you have to be clear that you have to do some work which you do not really want to work. So if you want to make some free software, you don't want to nurse other people to stay together, but it's kind of necessary. And finally, you are more or less a connection to the outer world. So, the DBM mail project, for instance, has a website. There is the address of the mailing list, and anywhere on this page, I think I removed my email address. What was my email address? And people want to talk to a person, not to a list. This is, in principle, stupid, because I'm reading the list, and the list is much more sane than me. But, people try to talk to me, especially this kind of people, this medical people need some character to speak to. And so, we have to be kind of the connection to the outer world. And if this connection is, well, just forward the problem to the mailing list, this is also fine. In most cases, this is fine because people want to become informed, and you know who are the competent people who can inform those people and answer questions, or you do it yourself. And another way is, if people come to you and want to know something, and on the other hand, sometimes you have to make connections to similar projects who might be targets for co-working, or do something in common. So you are, or your task it is to go to these people and talk to them. What can be enhanced?
I'm missing one item there on that page. And that is make decisions. it's not always relevant. In some projects, it's more important than other projects. But in the end, when there's no clear consensus on a list, or when certain individuals are trying to push something that for them privately is very important, but that, for example, would risk a release or the stability of a release, as a leader, you cannot be too afraid to make decisions about and just say very firmly, okay, we are not going to do that for this release, but we'll include it in the next release, we'll look at it again then. If you do not make decisions as a leader, it will often kind of put the project in an uncertain state and lead to stasis rather than progress.
You have two situations when that happens. There are no decisions being made in the two kinds of project groups. One group is one which has a clear set of procedures and processes. It has a documented setting for this and that. It has bug reports, mailing list archives, old members who still linger on and everything. And you have a group which doesn't have anything documented. And I mean documented in the widest possible sense. The poor man's documentation of, just the proceedings, not like a mailing list archive or something. They don't have nothing documented. And in the first group, there will be a stagnation. But in the second group, there will be a cabal. The people will think nothing is going on because the cabal is obstructing us. That will happen just because of lack of transparency, lack of process. Establishing this process will help you actually when you can't make a decision, at least you can stall it. People will see why it's hard and they will see, okay, there will be a problem, but the problem won't be so escalated.
So finally, does this idea scale? Well, in the beginning I told you I was a little bit scared about holding this talk, and I think it was good that I started it and we collected some ideas. I forgot, obviously. I'm not sure whether all these ideas really scale for Debian as a whole. So I wish you good luck.
Stay nice.
It is. All I said is probably valid for not elected leader roles, so which are one of these duocracy principle. If if you are an elected leader, people have some other expectation, and perhaps you might have a handle. I don't know. We have the policy and other means, so it might be a little bit different. So all this I said is more or less restricted to personal experience, and so we just talked about your experiences, and if you have some more input, I would be really happy and then make a version 2 or whatever of these slides and come back later on.
Isn't replacement the handle against somebody? So if you say you are maintaining your package not good enough, here Mr. X wanted to do it and you are being replaced, and this is a decision by a leader, not...
Yeah, but this is what I mean with it, what I said does not really scale for Debian, because you have an elected leader roles with delegation rights. This is a little bit stronger than what I presented here. And this is possibly an option to do something.
But it's only one handle, and it's a very strong handle. You don't always want to use it. You don't want to replace somebody just
only as last step. Not. Yeah. If you disagree,
the problem is, if I would be in the shoes of the Debian leader and would go to some person and said, I would like to replace you, would you be strong enough to say this to somebody? I think I wouldn't. And this is a problem.
Yeah, then this is a discussion of a strong leadership and decision.
It's different between a strong leadership and a strong person. And also, if you are a strong person, you most people have not the courage to go to somebody and say, go away, and some other takes your job. It's really a hard decision.
I think that even if you are an elected leader for such a decision, for such an action, you would need really strong backing.
Yeah.
Before you would be able to do that.
And that's actually the idea of the
state.
That's actually the idea of the social committee. My idea was, if there would be a social committee, you have some people who are also responsible for such a decision. And it is not that the person who is replaced says, well, you don't like the color of my hair. That's the reason.
Yeah.
No, but we people think there should be some change. This is different.
Another advantage of having a social committee would be that the process of reaching that decision would become better documented, because it would have been discussed over a longer period of time in the social committee, and they would probably do some kind of investigation into mailing list history and interview people about what they think about the situation. So. I agree, the social committee would be probably improve our handling of social issues.
If you combine the issues of leadership and the social issue, the social committee is supposed to be just an advisory body, but the leadership stuff. In Debian, we have this weird binary situation. Someone mentioned it, and I, of course, reacted to this. We have one leader whose responsibility is everything executive in Debian, and everyone else is like feet in the air, and we can just leave it to the leader to decide. That's a really silly approach. We need to layer it down. Like the responsibility for individual packages is rests on the person in the maintainer and the uploader's field. There should be a layered down version of most decisions, because that makes them documentable, because there's overhead. There's obviously overhead and everything, but we can probably work on some acceptable level of overhead. So sometimes I resented the leaders before Sam. You're not gonna get that. You get frustrated. Many people did. I saw this in discussions. Why didn't people decide on this? Why wasn't there something done? Because you can't really expect one person to bear the whole burden of 1,000 desires, 1,000 frustrations, 1,000 everything.
Basically, that is the reason that DPL has the ability to call a GR basically just by himself. While regular developers
But we don't use that, so...
No, it's not used, but is that a problem of
the system, or is that a problem of the DPLs maybe?
I would be inclined to say it's a problem in the system. You know, it was unrealistic to expect that the DPL would really bother 1,000 people for...
But he's elected by the majority.
Yeah.
So he has the power, in my opinion. So when he's the majority...
Yeah.
Okay.
He's elected by the conversation.
That's very important, yes. Because you can have maybe one-fourth of the whole DevRel community who agrees with what the leader says, and whether he won the election or not doesn't say anything about what GR would say.
And the GR doesn't
still winning the election.
And the GR doesn't have to be connected even with his platform. Maybe you voted for a platform, but you voted for a person. But a GR means maybe.
Where does the leader take the legitimacy for all his decisions? You know.
By being the leader, he's winning.
We don't have that in practice.
What you're talking is basically representative democracy. Mm-hmm. I mean, you vote for, I don't know, a party, a platform, however you call it, and not every decision that in the end you get out of the system is the one that you would have voted for. Well, that's the deal with the representative democracy.
But in this case, if you have a problematic decision to take, you can get GR and all the people would say,
You can get the GR, it makes it sound so easy. But it's not really. We don't do it so easily.
If you don't feel comfortable because you're just being elected by 50% of it or whatever, you can't get people to decide.
We don't have precedent for that kind of thinking. You know, we don't have leaders. You know, we have like 8 people as DPL. No, they are all different. Some were strong, some were weak, some were mediocre, some were, you know, good or something, but none of them actually utilize these options. But that makes me wary of these options. They are not really theoretically sound.
For example, if an issue was in the DPL's platform and he's running into a block of some kind, in that case, I think calling a GR on the issue, saying, well, this issue was apparently important to people because it was one of the main points of my platform, so I expect it's part of why I was elected, but I'm running into this block. I propose that the project shows its support for this issue so that I can move forward, and I propose to do the following. I think that would be an excellent use of a general resolution.
I think it's more important to think about big, hard issues. Like, suppose we decided we're going to scrap all of the Debbie decided they're going to scrap all of their various version control systems and switch to Mercurial or something. That is a decision that you might want to. It's a big decision, requires a lot of people involved. You might want to do a GR to get Debian as a whole stamp on it, and then therefore cause everybody to go, well, okay, I lost, but we decided to vote for it, so we're going to go for it on it anyway. So I think GR is good for big things.
Yes, absolutely.
Something you were pointing out. Yes, nobody in Debian so far, nobody of the DPLs so far used that. Well, I wasn't part of the project yet when the current governance model was decided, when the constitution was drafted and all that. But as far as I understand, well, this is a unique group that came up with a legal system basically out of nowhere. So yes, there's also something I have talked with some people. We have some documents we consider basically as sacred, where they should not be. They should be amended every now and then. And it's very hard to do it.
You need to know that the constitution was specifically drafted to prevent the project leader from going insane and having too many powers. So it didn't really come from nowhere. It was because at that time in Debian there were issues with the project leader and they didn't want them to appear.
Yes. So this history is placing a burden on all of us, you know, into today, because yes. We are all influenced by this thinking. Okay, it has to be a laissez-faire democracy. It has to be very free, everybody has to be, remain free to be a volunteer. And you know, that's the point. We all need to be, need to take on a leadership role and discuss and vote on a GR that would change something, something substantial in the whole procedure.
So should we use GRs more often?
No, actually.
So we see the majority wants this, and then we use it more often for problems.
The problem here is that you're asking the question. You're not giving the answer. You know,
yes,
talking about leadership.
I think using GRs within Debian turns it into a very authoritarian leadership model, which is a total anathema to the way free software works. Free software doesn't like having general resolutions, and well, 52% said this is going to happen, so this is what's going to happen. So almost pulling it a little bit back onto your slide, Andreas, about what the Debian project as a whole can do. I think there are a whole bunch of things that the Debian project can do, and probably let's get away from this GR and authoritarian leadership, because it's not going to work. But I think the Debian project, and you talked about communication and regular updates and things like that in one of your earlier slides, and I think that's one of the great things that Debian can do. We've got dozens of IRC channels and dozens of mailing lists and all that sort of stuff. So to one extent, we're totally swamped with communication. But on the other extent, when the project leader puts out on Debian Announce or whatever, a status or a SIP rep or something like that, and if the project leader tied it into, well, these are release goals for Lenny and this is how we're tracking against it and this is what people can do to get Lenny in shape, or this is what the QA team are doing, or this is what the various projects are doing, it's that communication. And I think if Debian as a project and the DPL as a body uses the leadership in that way and say, well, this is what's happening, if people wish to channel their efforts, this is the way Debian as a whole, the release team are driving this, the QA team are driving this, the FTP masters are driving this, then at least people are getting sort of a regular update from the top, from the lead, saying, well, if you wish to be part of Debian, this is how the project's going as a whole, rather than saying, well, we're gonna raise a GR and say that these are the release goals for Lenny. I don't think if we have a GR and it says these are the release goals for Lenny,
it's a wrong subject.
It's the wrong tool. Whereas if the release team come up with some considered release goals for Lenny, which is what they're doing, and then the project leader then pumps that for the next 12 months, and every month says, well, these are the release goals, this is what you as an individual developer could be doing to forward your part of Debian towards the release goals, I think that could be quite useful and quite a non-authoritarian, quite a good free software leadership model to take forward.
I totally disagree that GRs are about being authoritarian. I think GRs are about reaching consensus. If you look at the GR on the GFDL, where basically the group of people most involved with the GFDL, Debian Legal, had a lot stricter standpoint than probably the majority of the developers. The GR actually was a very good and effective way to break that discrepancy between kind of the most vocal, the standpoint of the most vocal people, and the general viewpoint of Debian developers, by just asking the Debian developers, who are not involved in this discussion on Debian Legal because it basically never goes anywhere and whatever.
It should be noted that Debian both mailing list participants did a good job on that resolution. Mm-hmm. You know, the GR itself was just a consequence of having three options.
Yes.
You know, each of these three options was supported by like a dozen people.
Yes.
And these dozens of people did a good job. I mean, the Debian Legal group stated their point. These guys stated theirs, these guys stated theirs, and then we had a relatively easy vote.
Yeah. And I agree that there have also been GRs where the options really were all very bad and didn't really present
further discussion
real alternatives to what was being handled. But if that happens on Debian vote, it's basically a joint responsibility of all developers, and any developer who is not on Debian vote kind of sucks.
Don't be so harsh. One underlying point. We don't actually have a procedure to raise a good DPL. You know, the only procedure when we have people messaging 1,000 people and not, you know, we have a large mailing list like the Devel, Devin Devel, it has, I don't know how many, 1,200 people. You know, but it's a bazaar. If you scream at it, nobody actually hears you. So you can scream at it. But if you yell on Devin Devel announce, that's a completely different picture. So we don't have a, you know, a system of breeding, I don't know if that, I spell that right, pronounce it right, right? We don't have this kind of leadership. So I don't really expect the leaders to be very good at it. But, you know, these bits from the DPL idea was a good thing. It was a major step ahead. You know, the other leaders didn't have this goal to, you know, just go out there and say something. It was maybe what they said was not authoritative, but it when you send it to a list like that, it sounds like it. Even if you mean it, you know, in a completely consensus-driven way, it sounds, it has weight. So there's a responsibility there. So, but hey, the problem is we don't have a system that produces people who can do that. That's the problem, I think. So. I don't have a solution, but at least some general idea.
It's somewhat self-selecting.
Self-selecting, yeah. That's a problem in itself. No.
Yes.
You have to have self-loving people.
Yeah, that's probably a politician.
No offense, Sam. You know, there's always that problem. Hi, Sam.
Recorded? Yes.
Yeah.
Now I'm famous.
By the way, there is one option to yell on David Devel, just write the word Ubuntu at the top. Everybody will notice.
Yeah, but increasingly people will ignore you.
Yeah. I hope so. But you are right, it is really, really hard to get focus on the people with this general mailing list and so on. General resolution is also something, well, people normally tend to, they want to do some programming, some hacking, and this organizing and so on. I don't know how many people are with help on Debian board. I admit I'm not.
We have about 400.
400. So not everybody, not the Debian developers, but also others. So maybe 1/3 of the Debian developers is.
I have no idea how many Debian developers.
Yeah,
I have no idea.
Far fewer than.
No, but
should be.
but taking on what's being said also. another thing I think is problematic, but there's no way I can conceive around it. Is that GR, yes, it's a very dangerous tool if not used right. I don't know, we have some editorial examples we can refer to. But it's such a long process that it discourages people from introducing GRs.
And also what I wanted also to mention is that if you look at how many people voted for the Debian DL, also 1/3 of the DL, so about people, do not really like to vote over and over. And
well, taking into account that the people who you know, the people who are here in DevConf, are the people, the developers that are most interested in the project.
Yeah, sure.
Many people are interested in making a Linux distribution better for their users, and it happens to be Debian.
And we have this huge number of MIA developers that we do not know about at all. I guess more than half of the developers actually voted for the legal elections. I hope we can get more figures and metrics about who is MIA and who is really active in the project.
I think if you would correlate with that data about uploads and voting for DPL, it would turn out quite strong.
I'm not really convinced that. Probably also those kind of developers who upload in regularly but do not care about anyone.
Well, no, there's a fair few. There's also people who actively maintain one or two packages in a very specific field and basically don't care about Debian as a project at all, but just care about it as a vehicle to get their software. And that's fine, that's absolutely fine. I'd rather that those people do not vote, because they probably are not informed.
I'm saying it's fine if they don't vote.
If they are not informed, if they don't care about the project at that level, then please don't vote. Leave the decision to the people who
have some kind of self-control.
Just a little bit of statistics. David was kind enough to let me check. We have 500 people on Debian Vote, 2,000 on Debian Devel, and 5,600 on Debian Devel announce. Mm. That's really like this. So, addressing
Debian Devel. Who of them are Debian developers?
Well, if only 3,000 are, I'm scared. It's intimidating.
But Debian Devel announce is read by a lot of users of Debian, because basically the regular announce list is dysfunctional. If you want to know anything about Debian and what's going on and what may affect your installation, you're much better off reading Debian Devel announce. Basically, because it has, on average, very good and useful announcement and not trivial stuff flashing by, so it's not having a burden for you.
There's 28,000 people on Debian announce. Not getting any mail.
Probably very happy about that.
Well, it's a stable operating system. What do you want?
But the balance handler on the list system, I'm a list master, so I don't know this kind of thing. The balance handler goes wild every time there's a post on the announce, because they keep piling up, and then the first post gets like 1,000 bounces or 5,000 bounces. It's completely insane.
So how many people are booted?
600.
600, right. Which is quite large. Especially if you consider the amount of traffic boot is getting. But it's one of the largest.
Okay, I'll take advantage of this period of silence. We are out of time, so thank you very much.
Thank you, Andreas.